Church.
Morning. There you go. I want to welcome my voice to this room today. And we're glad everybody's here with us today. And we're going to celebrate our God, that He is greater than any other. Listen to these words from the psalmist. It's found in Psalm 95. It says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before Him with thanksgiving and extol Him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In His hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to Him. The sea is His, for He made it, and His hands formed the dry land. Come," the psalmist said, "let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care." Psalm 95 said that the Lord is the great God. He is the God. Do you believe that today? He's not a God. He is the God. Say that with me. He is the God. But let me tell you my favorite part of this psalm. It's not the verse that says that He is the great God. That's a great verse. But my favorite verse is the one that says, "And He is our God." Can you say that with me? Our God. It's one thing to know that He is the great God, but it's something else to say He is not just the Lord, He is my Lord. He is our Lord. Let's bow our hearts all over this room as we pray. We know many of you are joining us online right now, wherever you are. We want to just stop and pause and just take a moment to say thank you, Jesus. Our Father in heaven, we thank you, we praise you. We want to enter your gates with thanksgiving. We want to come into your courts with praise. Lord, you are the great God. But Lord, thank you today that you are our God. That the God, the awesome God of creation, is also a personal God. The God who is there is the God we can know. And so, Lord, today we just welcome your presence in this place. We know, Father, there are men and women, young people, boys and girls, Lord, there's folks all over this room today, all across our campus. Some are hurting. Some need just a sense of your presence and your power today. Maybe some who feel alone. Maybe somebody here today that's discouraged or just struggling. Lord, we pray that today they would sense your presence and your love and your grace, your purpose. Lord, we pray for anybody here today that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior. Maybe they're just lost and they don't know what they need, but they know they need something. We pray that today they would find that it's not something, it's someone. And Lord, we pray that we would all find ourselves just in your presence today. You said if we draw near to you, you would draw near to us. So Lord, draw near today. Your word says to seek the Lord while he may be found and call on him while he's near. And so Lord, we just thank you that you are near to us today. And we pray that you would meet everyone today at the point of our need for Jesus' sake. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed all over this room, I'm going to do something a little different today. Would you just stay in a spirit of prayer for a minute? And while we pray all over this room, let's do something. Would you just pray for the person sitting next to you? It may be a friend. It may be family. It may be somebody you know. Maybe it's somebody you don't even know. Just take a moment right now silently and just pray for somebody that's right next to you. You don't know what's going on, but the Lord does. Would you pray for them? And then let's do this. Why don't you just take just a quiet moment and just pray for yourself. Would you make this your prayer today? Lord, speak to my heart today. Whatever you say, I will obey. God, open our eyes, open our hearts today to see you, to hear from you. And Lord, we thank you that you are the great God. And you are our God. We want to come before the Lord and bless your holy name for Jesus' sake. Everybody said, amen.
Before we start singing this song, there's something that's in my heart to say. You know, oftentimes we come to church and in our mind we say, okay, I'm going to church and I expect to get something out of that service. I want to get something from God today. I want to get a word. As I was thinking and I realized that, what if it was the other way around? What if we come to church to give something? To give God worship, to worship him. Because whatever we may think we come to church to receive, he already knows it. Before we were born, he knew what you needed. This is already done, he knows that. But what if we come to church in a spirit of giving? Give him glory, worshiping him. Because he deserves all the worship, he deserves all the glory, because he is God. Now let us stand up and worship God. Let's give him, you know, the worship that he deserves.
Let me see. Beautiful.
Church, let's say that.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Let's say it.
Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. Amen. Worthy is the Lamb. Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. You are here. Hurt me in this place. I worship you.
Let's say it.
I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker,
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here. Healing every heart. I worship you. I worship. Church, let's sing. You are, you are.
Waymaker, miracle worker,
promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker,
Waymaker,
miracle worker,
promise keeper,
light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop
working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working.
You never stop, never stop working.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
One last time, let's say that.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, my God, that is who you are.
Amen, amen. God bless you. Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn to the Old Testament book of Zephaniah. Zephaniah, a little short minor prophet, right at the end of the Old Testament. So if you come to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, take a left. And one of the last few books before we get to the New Testament is the little book of Zephaniah. Now, do you want the good news or the bad news? How many people always want to hear the bad news first? The word gospel literally means good news. The one of the biggest news stories of the last 50 years was the O.J. Simpson trial. How many of you remember where you were during the Bronco chase. Do you remember that moment? It's like one of those snapshots in history. Where were you when JFK was assassinated? Where were you on 9/11? I was a student at Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary when the OJ verdict came down. When the news came out, they were about to, the jury was in, they were going to give the announcement of the verdict. I was in Fort Worth, Texas between classes, and I jumped in my car and I was running around town trying to find a place with a television where I could see and hear the verdict live. And so as I was running around, I was listening to the radio, but I wanted to see a television screen. And so I actually found a bar in Fort Worth, Texas, across the street from my seminary. And I think I might have been the only ordained Baptist preacher in the bar at that time in the middle of the day. And I remember the moment that I heard that verdict. Do you know that's what the word gospel in the New Testament means? It's actually the word picture is somebody standing on the steps of the Supreme Court and announcing the verdict, and that the verdict is good news. You know, to a lot of people today, Christianity is not good news. You know what I think most people think when they hear about the Christian faith, or they think about the Bible or the church, the gospel? I think what many people believe is that Christianity is good advice. Isn't that what a lot of people think of? That the Christian message, the message of the Bible, that Christianity is basically just a bunch of good advice. And friends, I've got news for you today. The Christian gospel is not just good advice. It is good news. The former publisher of the Washington Post famously said that news, his definition of news was this: it is the first rough draft of history. A CNN commentator recently said, you've heard the phrase, no news is good news. And a CNN commentator said, the reality is in today's media, good news is no news. How many of you have ever watched the Channel 7, 10 o'clock news? You ever watch that news channel? One of the highest rated local news programs in America is in South Florida. And there's a saying in news that if it bleeds, it leads. I don't know about you, but I've never turned on the news at 10 o'clock on Channel 7 and heard good news, right? No news is good news, but the reality is to many people today, good news is no news. H.L. Mencken, the writer and satirist, said that journalism is something someone doesn't want you to know. Everything else is just public relations. How many of you believe that news people today, the news media, how many of you believe what you hear on the news? Anybody? You know, for a lot of you that are here today, when you think of a news person, when you think of somebody in news, you know, people that are of a certain age will think of Walter Cronkite. You know that name? Some of you that are younger, you don't even know who Walter Cronkite is. For 25 years, Walter Cronkite was known as the most trusted man in America. And does anybody remember how he ended every broadcast on CBS for 20-something years? He would say this, and that's the way it is. And that's the way it is. In the book of Zephaniah, what we're going to find is some bad news, and then the greatest news you have ever heard. I'm going to tell you three reasons why the gospel is not just good advice. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the best news you could ever hear.
The most trusted person in America used to be the newsman. But today, nobody believes the news anymore. America is so polarized politically. Have you noticed today that politics is like high fructose corn syrup? You say, what do you mean by that? Here's what I mean. Politics is like high fructose corn syrup. It's in everything now. Everything's got high fructose corn syrup in it, right? When you read the ingredients. And today, everything is political. So nobody trusts. One person watches one news channel and they hear what they want to hear. Another person watches another station so they can hear what they want to hear. One party looks at the other party. They don't believe anything those people say. The other people look back and it's exactly the same right back at you. Do you know who the most trusted person in America is today? It's not a pastor. It's not a politician. It's not a newsman. The most trusted person in America today is Tom Hanks. According to public opinion polls, Tom Hanks is the most trusted person in America. Friends, what a commentary on our culture that an entertainer, a movie star, listen to this, a person who pretends to be someone else for a living is the most trusted person in the world. Let's look at the Old Testament book of Zephaniah. And if you don't have a Bible, you can just look at the screen. We're going to give you the verses here as we read. And I'm going to skip over to the third chapter. Now, Zephaniah is only three short chapters, but just for the sake of time today, I want you to look at Zephaniah chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. And we're going to read some bad news, and then we're going to get some good news. Are you ready? Zephaniah 3, verse 1, it says, "Now woe to the city of oppressors, rebellious and defiled." What city is he talking about? He's a prophet. He's prophesying against Jerusalem. He's prophesying to the nation of Judah. He's a contemporary of Isaiah. And so Zephaniah has a lot in common with Isaiah. In some ways, Zephaniah is like the cliff notes of Isaiah. If Jonah was the prophet of the second chance, Zephaniah is the prophet of the last chance. And he's like God's final word to Jerusalem. And he's saying, listen, trouble's coming. There's bad news. Our sin brings judgment. And he says, she obeyed. Look at verse 2. Does this sound like somebody that lives at your house that you're trying to raise? They obey no one. She accepts no correction. She does not trust in the Lord. She does not draw near to her God. He says that the people of Jerusalem, they wouldn't listen to God. They wouldn't draw near to him. Her officials, look at verse 3. You want to talk about church and state? They're not separated in Zephaniah 3. The Bible says they're both completely corrupt. It says, her officials within her are roaring lions. Her rulers are evening wolves. They leave nothing for the morning. He says, look, your own government is like a predator that's out to get you and take power and take privilege from you. Look at verse 4. Is the church any better than the state? He says, her prophets are unprincipled. They are treacherous people. Listen to this. Can you believe, how many people think the Bible is relevant for today? He says, you want to know how bad your society is? Your government officials are a bunch of crooks, and your preachers can't be trusted. What a commentary on society. It's tragic, but it's true. He says, your prophets are unprincipled. They are treacherous people. Her priests profane the sanctuary. They do violence to the law. Can't trust the mayor. Can't trust the preacher. What is he saying? He's saying, you can't trust anybody anymore. There's no Walter Cronkite anymore that everyone in America trusts and believes in. We've lost trust in institutions. Does that sound like it might as well be reading out of the newspaper. This is how people feel today. And listen to what he says. Verse 5. But the Lord within her is righteous. He does no wrong. Morning by morning, he dispenses his justice. And every new day, he does not fail. Yet the unrighteous know no shame. The New Testament says, hey, there's going to be terrible times in the last days. And Zephaniah saw it. He saw it 1,000 years before Christ. He says, listen, there's going to be terrible times. Anytime there's sin, there's going to be sorrow. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, in the midst of all this pain, in the midst of all this injustice, in the midst of all this suffering, there's a God who is good. Listen, just because life isn't fair, that doesn't mean God is unjust. God is not life. He's over life. He's above life. He is more than life. He may be the source of our life, but listen, just because your world doesn't make sense, it doesn't mean that God doesn't make sense. And listen to what it says, verse 6. He says, I've destroyed nations. Their strongholds are demolished. I've left their streets deserted. No one passing through. Their cities are laid waste. Zephaniah is saying, Jerusalem, this is what's going to happen. God says to people, if you turn away from me, this is what life is going to be like. Oh, Jerusalem, I thought, of Jerusalem, I thought, surely you will fear me and accept correction. Then her place of refuge would not be destroyed, but they were still eager to act what? Corruptly in all they did. God said, surely they're going to turn around. Surely they're going to say 1 + 1 = 2. When I sin, I suffer. So why would people continue to sin? But there's something about human nature. I want what I want, and I want it now. And yet God says, I just thought for sure they would come around. But no, they have acted corruptly. The government is corrupt. The churches are corrupt. The politicians, the preachers. You can't trust the guy on the evening news. You can't trust the person next door to you. You can't trust anyone or anything. So, what have we just read in the first 8 verses of Zephaniah chapter 3? Bad news. Are you ready? Because sinners in the hands of an angry God is getting ready to turn over to Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Are you ready? I'm going to lead a little singing today. Would that be okay? You're free to preach next week, all right? Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Zephaniah tells me so. The whole book of Zephaniah, from chapter 1, verse 1 to chapter 3, verse 8, has been bad news. Sinners in the hands of an angry God, the just judgment and the justice, the wrath of God, and the whole book is going to swing like it's on hinges. And between chapter 3, verse 8 to chapter 3, verse 9, now all of a sudden it's Jesus loves me. This I know. In fact, you understand the whole Bible in a sense. The Old Testament gives us the law of God. The New Testament gives us the grace of God. The Bible says Jesus was full of grace and truth. The Bible speaks of a God of mercy and love, but he's a God of holiness and judgment. Friends, the reality is this. For so many people, their image of God is distorted because they think he's one or the other. Some people think that God is like Santa Claus, and some people think he's the Grinch who stole Christmas. But the reality is, God is loving and merciful, but he is also just. He's not one or the other. He is grace and he is truth. So the reality is, the message of the gospel is either bad news or good news, not depending on where he is, but depending on where you are. How many people think Jesus' message to the Pharisees sounded an awful lot like bad news when he called them a bunch of vipers and snakes, told them essentially in so many words that if they kept on the road they were on, they were going to split hell wide open? Sounds like bad news, doesn't it? But it wasn't his message that had changed. It was their lives that needed to change. He found the woman caught in adultery, and what did he say? He said, go and sin no more. I'm not here to stone you. In other words, if you come to Christ in humility and repentance, then all you get is wide open arms of love ready to embrace you. Not a clenched fist, not a pointed finger, not crossed arms. But in other words, the reality is, he is God. He is the God. He can be your God. And friend, you can meet him however you like. You can meet him in grace and forgiveness and mercy, or you can meet him in judgment and wrath. It is entirely up to you. What does it say? Look at Zephaniah chapter 3 and verse 9. We're going to find three reasons the gospel is good news here in this one verse. Are you ready? Look at verse 9. It says, then I will purify the lips of the peoples, that all of them may call on the name of the Lord and serve him shoulder to shoulder. Read that with me one more time. Listen to this. Verse 9. Then, that's a big word. You know why? Because all throughout Zephaniah's three little short chapters, he keeps talking about the day of the Lord. The great day of the Lord. It's near. The day of the Lord is near. Near and coming quickly. He's talking about a day of judgment, but he's also talking about a day of hope and restoration. He says, then on that day, on the great day of the Lord, what am I going to do? First of all, notice he says, I will purify the lips of the peoples. Now, when you were a kid, did your mom ever tell you, when she heard you say some words that you didn't usually say in Sunday school, did you ever have a mom or dad say they were going to wash your mouth out with soap? How many of you ever had your mouth washed out with soap? Let me see your hands. That ever happened to you? I didn't see Bonnie raise her hand over there. Bonnie didn't even know what a curse word was until she married a preacher. So she never heard one before. So, and then once she met me, she started using them all the time. No, I'm just teasing. He says, listen, I'm going to purify the lips of the people. What's the picture there? Friends, the picture is your mom washing your mouth out with soap. God says, first thing I'm going to do is clean and purify your lips. Does that sound like another prophet? Isaiah chapter 6, verses 5 through 7. Bruce, do we have that? Isaiah chapter 6, verses 5 through 7, one of the beautiful passages about worship in the Old Testament. Isaiah says, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. What did I do? Woe to me, I cried. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean, what? Lips. And I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. In Hebrew poetry, when the Bible talks often about the lips, or the spoken word, in the Hebrew context, what you said was a symbol of what you were going to do. So what he's saying here, when he talks about cleaning up their lips, What he's talking about is cleaning up their lives, their behavior. He says, I'm ruined. I'm a man of unclean lips. He's saying, I'm a sinner. I got a dirty mouth that's the result of a dirty heart. And my dirty heart and my dirty mouth are producing a dirty life. Somebody said, dusty Bibles lead to dirty lives. And that's what Isaiah was talking about. I'm ruined. Isaiah said, you know what the problem is? The problem is not out there. The problem is in here. The problem is me. I am the problem. A newspaper editor sent a letter to G.K. Chesterton years ago in Great Britain, and he said, what's wrong with the world? And G.K. Chesterton sent back a letter with two words, I am. That's what Isaiah said. He said, I am. I'm ruined. Look at what it says in verses 6 and 7. Then one of the seraphim, this angelic being, flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. It was too hot to touch. And look at verse 7. With it, he touched my mouth. And he said, see, this has touched your lips. Look at that word. Your, say it with me, guilt is taken away and your sin is atoned for. Have you ever heard the phrase scapegoat? You know what that phrase comes from? It comes from an Old Testament, it comes from a biblical context where they would take a goat or a lamb and they would bring the lamb into the village and everyone would bring an old cloak, a jacket, a coat, a blanket, and they would symbolically lay their coats or cloaks over that animal. And then the animal would be sent away out into the wilderness. And it would carry all their sin and guilt. And that is what a scapegoat means. The biblical picture of forgiveness in this passage is that God is going to take hot coals and put them on your lips. And of course, what he means is he's going to take the heat of his holiness and his justice, his mercy. He's going to apply it to your heart, to your life, and that your sin and guilt is going to be taken away from you. The Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the sins of us all. Jesus, the Lamb of God. Do you know what the Lamb of God means in a practical sense? The Lamb of God means that he's the scapegoat and he takes all your sin away. And your sin can be nailed to the cross. I love the old hymn that says, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. What is the gospel? If you have something to write with, jot this down real quick. Number one, what does verse 9 teach? First of all, the gospel is not just good advice, it's good news. Number one, for the guilty. The gospel is good news for the guilty. If you're here today and you're a sinner, listen, you say, Pastor, my life is bad news. My world is bad news. My situation, my relationships, everything about my life is bad news. Why? Because I am ruined. I'm a sinner. Even when I try to do things right, I always mess it up. That's the story of the human condition. But the reality is this. It's not bad news if you're a sinner. If you're a sinner, the gospel is good news. Because it's good news for the guilty. And what is that message? It is that God will forgive you. Friend, the gospel is good news to the world. It's good news for me. It's good news for you. It's good news for the guilty. It means God will forgive you. God will forgive you. Isn't it amazing that in the gospel, you can meet God where? At the point of your greatest weakness, our guilt and our shame. Jesus will meet you right there. Do you understand if you're here today and you have really messed up? Can I get an amen? Anybody in here that, man, you're a sinner. God will meet you where? Friend, he doesn't meet you on top of the mountain. He'll meet you down in the valley. He's the lily of the valley, and he will meet you at rock bottom. You don't need to clean up your act to meet Jesus. You can just meet him right where you are. He'll meet you where you are. Say, Pastor Stephen, is this cheap grace? Are you just saying people can do whatever they want to do? They just say some little prayer, and God doesn't care, and they can do it over and over and over again? Listen, God will meet you right where you are, but he loves you too much to let you stay there. He will begin to work in you. He'll begin to change you. He'll begin to transform you. But I can tell you this right now, it doesn't start with your willpower. It starts with his divine power. It starts with just saying, God, I'm helpless, hopeless, like sheep without a shepherd, harassed and helpless, and I need a Savior. I need your grace, and I don't bring anything with you except my spiritual poverty. And I just say, Jesus, I need you. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And if you will make that your prayer, you can meet him today. You can meet him right where you are. Some people say, you know, man, I haven't hit rock bottom yet. Can I tell you a little secret about rock bottom? Rock bottom always has a trap door. I don't care where you are. Trust me, it can get worse. What are you waiting for? You don't have to climb in a garbage dumpster to know it stinks. Wherever you are today, just remember this. It was my best thinking that got me here. And a problem can never be solved on the same level of thinking that created the problem. So what I need to do is put my life in God's hands. Can I tell you a little secret about guilt? In recovery, there's a saying, our secrets keep us sick. And I'm going to tell you, you don't need to tell everybody your deep, dark secret. Don't tell everybody. And you don't need to tell just anybody. But you do need to tell somebody. Somebody that loves you. Somebody you can trust. The Bible says if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just. He'll cleanse us and forgive us of all our sins. If you want to be forgiven, all you got to do is tell Jesus. Confess your sin and ask his forgiveness. That's it. It's good news for the guilty. God will forgive you. But can I tell you, it's even better news than that. Because the Bible says, now confess your sins to one another that you may be what? Healed. See, when you confess your sins to God, you receive his forgiveness. But how many of you ever done that and you're still hurting? I confess my sin, but I'm still alone. I'm still struggling. I don't feel good about where I am. I'm defeated. I'm frustrated. I'm discouraged. He says, listen, confess your sin to one another that you may be healed. Have you ever thought about how easy it is for God to forgive other people? Why is it so hard to realize and accept that he will forgive you? Aren't you just like other people? Somehow, some reason, I look at other people and I think, well, sure, God will forgive Teresa. God would forgive Jack. God would forgive Carol Joe. God would, will forgive Jody. But somehow when you look in the mirror, you say, I'm ruined. I'm undone. I am what I am. I cannot change. I'm ashamed of myself. And somehow you don't realize that that's what Teresa and Jack and Ashley and Carlos and everybody else is saying in their mirror. The gospel is good news for the guilty because it says God will forgive. He'll wash your mouth out, not with soap, but he will cleanse you with the blood of Jesus. There's a second reason. The gospel is not just good news for the guilty. God meets you at the point of your greatest weakness, but secondly, look at this, God's going to meet you at the point of your deepest need. Look at the middle of verse 9. That all of them may what? Call on the name of the Lord. I'm going to tell you, the gospel is good news, secondly, for the lonely. The gospel is good news for the lonely. Because what it means is this, God will not only forgive you, but God will hear you when you call his name. If you'll draw near to him, he will draw near to you. Listen to what it says in Isaiah 55 and verse 6. Isaiah 55 and verse 6. Do we have that on the screen? I read this, or I quoted this earlier. It says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Read it with me at the end. You ready? Call on him while he is near. Call on him while he is near. And he said, what is he saying? He's saying only the lonely can call on him and find that he is near. He's near to the brokenhearted. He saves those crushed in spirit. He doesn't just meet the guilty at the moment of your greatest weakness. He meets the lonely at the point of their deepest need. And the gospel is good news. Why? Because it means if you call on him, he will hear you. You understand that Christianity at its root, the Christian faith, is a love story. It's about a loving God who's chasing after fallen, sinful, broken man, and he wants to bring you back home. Ever since his justice demanded that Adam and Eve be thrown out of the Garden of Eden, the whole story of the Bible is CSI. It's Law and Order. It's a mystery novel. It's true crime. God is on a manhunt to find you. He's like the hound of heaven. He's chasing you down like a detective. He's looking for clues. He's trying to find you. He's trying to bring you back to himself. The Christian faith is a love story. The Bible itself is a love letter. And the gospel is a love song. I want to show you something you may have never seen. Bruce, we're going to look at verses 16 and 17 in Zephaniah chapter 3. If you have your Bible open, just skip down to verse 16. Zephaniah 3, verse 16. He says, now on that day, they'll say to Jerusalem, do not fear, Zion. Don't let your hands hang limp. The Lord your God is what? He's with you. The mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you. Look at the last phrase. Are you ready for this? But he will rejoice over you in singing. You know what's interesting about that verse? It is the only time in the Old Testament that God has a song in his heart because of his people. Isn't that amazing? I mean, Maya, we talked this morning about sometimes we come to worship, we're thinking about what we're going to receive, but we need to think about what we're going to give and how our life and our lips, our voice, our heart, our song, our music, our singing, it's an offering to God. And yet, this scripture says, listen, when you worship, you're not the only one whose voice is being heard. That God, in the gospel itself, He cleanses our lips. He purifies our lives, our hearts. In his forgiveness, in his mercy, he forgives us. But he also hears us. He fellowships. The Lord is with us, and he's singing over you. Bonnie and I talk all the time about these kids. They're growing up so fast. Can I get an amen? I mean, it feels like 3 weeks ago, we were sitting in a fertility specialist's office because we didn't think we were going to have any kids. And we'd been through heartbreak and heartache. And we're sitting in the doctor's office when we were sitting at a specialist's office when we found out she was pregnant with Caroline. And we prayed and prayed and prayed for God to give us. And then he answered with a downpour. We got five. And I can remember going into those rooms, into those nursery rooms, and standing next to that crib in silence and just watching their little bodies fill up with oxygen, and watching their little tummies go up and down while they slept. And the Bible says, if you think you know what it means to love your children, or to love a friend, or to love your family, or to be connected to other people, if you think you know what fellowship is all about, take that thought, multiply it times infinity, and take it to the depths of forever, and you will still barely have a concept of what he's talking about in this passage. He loves you with an everlasting love. He loves you so much that when he sees you returning to him in confession, and he forgives you, and you come to him in loneliness, and he hears you, and you become connected with him in fellowship, it says he can't help. He just starts singing. It's not just a love story. It's not just a love letter. But the gospel is a love song. It's about God's love for you. It's perfect. It's total. It's unconditional. It's life-changing. The Surgeon General of the United States says we have an epidemic in our society. And it's not COVID-19. It is loneliness. The Surgeon General of the United States says loneliness is at an epidemic proportion. That one in two Americans is struggling with loneliness in a measurable way that can give them heart disease and 10 other physical problems. Friends, that's why the gospel is not just good advice. The gospel's good news. It's good news for the guilty. It's good news for the lonely. And then finally, write this down, number 3. At the end of verse 9, he says, I'll purify your lips. They will call on the name of the Lord. And look at the end of this verse. It's so interesting. It says, and serve him, that all of them may call on the name of the Lord and serve him shoulder to shoulder. Now, that's an interesting Hebrew literary device. Because in the Old Testament, there's often a thing, you hear things like King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Holy of Holies. In Hebrew, when you put two words together and you repeat them, it's like for emphasis. It's like highlighting it, underlining it, putting an exclamation point on the end. And when it says here that these people, it's the gospel's good news for the guilty, that God will forgive you. He'll clean your mouth out. He'll clean your heart. It's good news for the lonely. You're going to call on him and he'll hear you. You can connect with him. And thirdly, it's good news for the empty. It means God won't just forgive you and hear you, but thirdly, he will use you. He'll give you something to do. He'll put you to work. He'll give you something, a bigger life, a better life, a brighter life. We talked about last week. God has a job for you to do that nobody else can do quite like you can. And he says these people are going to be forgiven. They're going to call on the name of the Lord. They're going to be in fellowship. And it says, and God is going to use them because they will serve him shoulder to shoulder. Friends, when you join the Lord's army, he doesn't hand you an M16 and send you to Russia or North Korea or China or Nazi Germany and say, good luck, go get Hitler. You ever hear about this guy from Texas that got on a plane, brought his father's hunting rifle, and he went to Afghanistan? He started marching all over Afghanistan looking for Saddam Hussein. You ever heard about this? Do you know how many millions of dollars the United States military spent? How many hundreds and dozens of people and millions of dollars was spent finding this guy and getting him home safely, who had put himself in this situation? Such a selfish, childish, foolish act. He thought he was such a courageous, brave hero. He was going to take his father's hunting rifle and go after and chase down Saddam Hussein or Osama bin Laden or whatever he had in his mind. And the United States military had to put incredible manpower and energy into finding this guy and bringing him home. Friend, when you go out to fight the enemy, you don't go out and fight them one-on-one. You fight them like they did in the movies with the gladiators and the Spartans, where they have those big shields that they use. Remember King Leonidas in the movie 300? And all those guys are there with their sword and their shield. He shows up with 300 warriors. And the other guy says, you only got 300 people. I got 3,000. He says, what are 300 people going to do? King Leonidas looks at the soldier standing behind that king. He says, what's your profession? And the guy says, I'm a candle maker. What's your profession? I'm a silversmith. He looks at his Spartan army of 300. He says, what's your profession? And Leonidas looks back at him. He says, hey, I brought more soldiers than you did. And what do? They take those shields and they put them over their head. And how are they protected from a shot from the side? Because the shields around them form an impenetrable cover so that you can't get them. As long as they've got somebody to their right and left, as long as they've got somebody in front and behind, the arrows can't hit them because they're serving shoulder to shoulder. The Bible says you're going to serve, but you're not going to serve all by yourself. You're going to serve right along, brothers and sisters in Christ. The gospel is good news, not just good advice. It's good news for the guilty, it's good news for the lonely, and it's good news for the empty. It says God has a bigger life for you, and he wants you to serve him shoulder to shoulder as a part of the body of Christ. Listen to what it says in Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 8. We read these first few verses a minute ago. Remember that guy that was ruined, that was undone? He was a man of unclean lips. But once God touched him by his grace and cleansed his sin, what was his immediate first reaction to experiencing the life-changing power of the gospel? Isaiah said, then, look at verse 8, then when? Once I had been forgiven, once I had been set free, once I had been changed, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And I said, say it with me, Here am I, send me. Here am I, send me. What is he saying? He's saying, the God you forgave me, God you hear me, and God I'm asking you to use me. I offer my life. This one life that will soon be passed, and only what's done for Christ will last. Who's the most trusted man in your life? I'll tell you who Zephaniah would say. He'd say, there's only one person, ultimately, that you can trust. And that's the Lord. New Testament says, whoever believes in him will never be disappointed. Let me ask you a question. Has a politician ever disappointed you? Are you ready? Has a preacher ever disappointed you? Has a spouse ever disappointed you? Has a parent? Has a child? Has a friend? But there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And friends, that's why the gospel is good news. And we're not the only ones singing today. Oh, it's not just you and me singing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. No, it is God himself, the Bible says, is singing over you when you come home to Christ. Let's bow our heads together and pray. Our hearts are bowed, our heads are bowed, eyes are closed all over this room. If you're here this morning and you know Jesus as your Savior, you say, Pastor Stephen, I know Christ. I've accepted Jesus as my Savior. He's washed all my sins away. I know that he lives in my heart. I know that he has a purpose for my life. I know the gospel is good news. It's good news for me today. Would you just take a moment while we pray all over this room and just thank God for Jesus. Just thank him for what he's done in you and for you and with you. Maybe you're here this morning, you say, Pastor Stephen, I don't know what I need, but I don't have a relationship with God like that. I've never connected with God. I believe in God. I know he's up there somewhere, but I don't know for sure that I really know him the way you're talking about it. And I want to. I want to know him. I want to go God's way today. What do I do? Would you just pray this simple prayer? Jesus walked along the seashore and he said to a bunch of fishermen, follow me. The Bible says, by grace we're saved through faith, that not of ourselves. It's the gift of God that no one can boast. If we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Just make this your prayer today. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive my sin. Come in today. Come in to stay. Just come into my life, Lord Jesus. The best I know how, I put my life in your hands. Jesus died on the cross to take away all your sin. He rose from the grave to give you a brand new life. You can be a new person today if you just say yes. Just make that your prayer today. Yes. I want to know Jesus. I want to follow Christ. I want to go God's way today. And the best I know how, I put my life in your hands. If you believe he'll do what he promised, just say, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. If you're a believer and you know somebody who needs to know Christ, would you just pray for them right now? Lord, I'm praying for my friend. I'm praying for my family. I'm praying for my neighbor. I'm praying for my friend at work. I'm praying for my person at school. I'm praying for my coach. I'm praying for my teacher. I'm praying for my grandchild. I'm praying for my son or daughter. Just take a moment right now. Lift their name to the throne of grace. Lord, thank you that you can purify our lips so that we could call on the name of the Lord, and that, Lord, you would use us to serve shoulder to shoulder for Jesus' sake, whose name we pray. Amen.
Church, let's stand up so we can worship God.
What can wash away my
bless you. You may be seated.
Can you just continue to play softly? And I'm just going to read a scripture. We're going to celebrate at the Lord's table today. Randy and Mike, I think you guys have some extras. So if anybody did not get a communion element today and you want one, just raise your hand and they'll bring it to you. Does anybody need one? The Apostle Paul said to the church at Corinth, I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the gospel, the good news, that God will forgive you, God will hear you, and that God will use you. Communion doesn't make you a Christian. Going to church, sitting in a room like this, singing songs, taking communion, throwing money in the offering basket, that doesn't make you a Christian any more than sitting in a garage makes you an automobile. What makes you a believer is that you have received Jesus as your Savior. You've given him your life. He gave his life for you. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So communion doesn't make you a Christian. Then why do we do it? Because it's a symbol of our faith. It's a way to remember. And it's a way to proclaim that faith. To say, I've accepted Jesus. His body that was broken for me. His blood that was shed. It has made me clean. It's made me new. And I want the world to know. That's what baptism does. Baptism is a symbol of faith in Jesus. And the Lord's Supper is a symbol of that same faith. He said, when you take the bread, remember the body of Christ that was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, Jesus held up the cup. He said, this is my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. Drink from it, all of you, for the forgiveness of your sins. Would you bow your hearts with me and let's pray. Lord, we love you today. We thank you for the gospel. We thank you for your amazing grace poured out on the cross for us. And we thank you for the good news that we can share with the whole world until everybody hears and everybody knows what you have done. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Next Sunday morning, we're going to kick off a brand new series. It's a fall church-wide campaign. Next Sunday morning, we're going to start a 28-day adventure in one of the mountain peaks of Scripture. We're going to be studying the 8th chapter of Romans. It has some of the most famous verses in all the Bible. And we're going to learn what it means to live in Christ and to lean on Christ and learn from Christ. And what it means that we are loved by Christ. And this series we're calling Unstoppable. It talks about all things work together for the good, that we are more than conquerors through Christ, that nothing can separate you from the love of God. And so what we're going to do is we're going to spend 28 days together as a church family learning what it means to have an unstoppable, unbreakable faith. If God is for us, who can be against us? And so we're going to be learning that and living that over the next 4 weeks. So we're going to have four sermons. So on Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, we'll gather for worship. Maya, we're going to have guest worship artists with us.
Yes.
You don't want to miss next Sunday morning. It's going to be a great, great time. It's going to be a great day of worship. We're going to be teaching on Romans chapter 8 all 4 weeks in the 8th chapter of Romans. Then what we're going to do is we're going to have a 28-day kind of quiet time plan, like a prayer, Bible reading, and prayer journal that we're going to give you. So if you're in church next Sunday, we're going to give you a booklet that's going to have a 28 days of Bible reading. It's going to take you through the whole book of Romans, and every day you're going to read one or two verses from the 8th chapter of Romans, along with the entire book of Romans. So if you'll come to church next Sunday, you're going to learn how to be unstoppable in your faith. You're going to have an opportunity to read and spend time with the Lord every day. 28 days can change your life. You know, psychologists say it takes 21 days to form a habit of medium complexity. And if you'll say, Lord, I'm going to spend time in your word and pray every day for 28 days, I'm going to tell you right now, it'll change your life. So we're going to have messages that will encourage you. We're going to have quiet time material for you to go through for the next month. And then we're going to offer all these different small groups. Did anybody get one of these flyers when you came in today? If you didn't see one of these, it says Unstoppable Grace Group Schedule. And I'm just going to read through this real quick. Pat, is that what you want me to do? We're just going to go through, and I want all the leaders that are going to lead these groups to stand up. Do they know that? So I hope we're not putting you on the spot. But look at this. We've got a ladies. We have 5 different groups of ladies. Tanya Haywood is in the back. Tanya, wave your hand if anybody's looking for a Sunday morning, 9 a.m., ladies' Bible study. You can see Tanya. Also, Monday, 10 a.m., Jacqueline Scott. Where's Wes? Wes, wave at us. By the way, pray for Jacqueline. She's home today, and we're praying for her. And Wes, we're going to have an opportunity for people to be prayed for after church today. You can stop by the corner. And we've got folks, Caroline and Wes, will pray with you and pray for you before you leave today. But pray for Jacqueline. And she's going to be leading a group on Monday mornings at 10 a.m. for ladies. There's also a ladies group Monday at 6 p.m. Where's Kim Morahan? Kim, are you out there? Kim, she's next door helping in the kids' wing. But she's going to have a group meeting in her house on Monday evenings at 6 o'clock. Thursday at 2 p.m., out in the mainlands, out west, Linda Mutchler. Paul was here earlier today, and I think Linda was having a rough time. She's at home, but we're praying for her. But she's going to lead a group that's going to be like in their housing community. So if you are looking for a ladies group out west, Thursday, 2 p.m. Men's group, Sunday, 9 a.m. Jack Fontaine, would you wave or stand up, everybody? Give him a big hand. Thank you, Jack. Jack, thank you for not standing all the way up, because it would make me look real short, because I'm standing on a thing and I'm about the same height as you right now. But Jack, we love you. He leads our men's group on Sunday mornings, 9 a.m. And men, if you're looking for a group, you can be with him. Just see him after church today. There's going to be a couples group Thursday night at 6:30 p.m. And it's going to meet here at the church. Jonathan, is that right? They're going to be in the fellowship hall. Jonathan and Diana, would you just wave at everybody or stand up where they can see you? This is a wonderful couple that are going to be leading that group on Thursday nights. Jonathan, it looks like it's going to be 6:30 p.m. next door in the fellowship hall. Did I get that right? So if anybody has any question about that, if you're a couple, you can go see them. It looks like couples, we're encouraging if you're 20s, 30s, and 40s, you're going to be with Jonathan and Diana Thursday night, 6:30 at Fellowship Hall. And then we're going to have single adults Sunday nights at 7. This is primarily young adults, so people that are like 18 to 29. Pat, is that right? Somewhere in there, early 20s, the younger group, and that's going to be with Alan and Ronnie. It's going to be at your house. Is that right? Alan, just stand up real quick. Everybody thank Alan and Ronnie for leading that group. So if you're in your early 20s, you want to meet with them. It's going to be next Sunday night, 7 p.m. You're going to have a barbecue and hang out. All the groups that I'm telling you, next week, starting Sunday or that week, whenever they meet, are just going to be having, Pat, a fellowship. It's just going to be, a lot of them are going to be having a meal. You can look up and get information. They'll tell you what's going on. But the first week is basically a party for you to bring some friends and meet people. And then the following 3 weeks, you're going to be going through Romans chapter 8 along with the sermons. We're going to learn about unbreakable faith. If you'll follow along on this page, you can see we've got Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, Tim and Gina Johnson. These are couples that are like 40 and up. Tim and Gina, just wave back there. Everybody can see them. And so we've several couples groups are going to be meeting. And Tim, is that going to be at your house? And if you need information, it's got every group leader's name and phone number right here. So you can meet them today right after church. You can see them next Sunday right after church. You can give them a call or a text, and they'll give you information. So that's wonderful. So we appreciate that. Singles that are a little middle age, median, at Pat and Robert's home. Pat and Robert, wave at us right there. That's also going to be on Thursday night at 7 o'clock. So there's a couples group. There's a singles group that's meeting. We'll have a great time. There's going to be a daytime senior. So if you're retired and you don't want to get out at night in your car, but you want to do a daytime group, there's going to also be one. You can contact Pastor Paul. It has his phone number there. And the day and time is still to be determined. But if you'll call him, that'll let us know how many people are interested in that probably lunchtime group, and then we'll get you the information. There's going to be a mixed group, kind of a kitchen sink for anybody and everybody, Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock at Lisa's home. Lisa, wave your hand. And so Doug and Lisa are going to be leading that group, and you can get their information. And that's anybody. It could be single, it could be couple, it could be somebody getting married on September 30th, right? It could be anybody. You guys love Doug and Lisa? Give them a big hand. And they're going to have a lot of fun. So if you're looking for a group, you can go there. Then you can keep going. We're going to have an online group. And Patrick and Patricia Hartman, do you know you're leading that group? Or did we just tell you you were? Awesome. So those of you watching us online, wave at Patrick and Patricia. We're going to offer a small group for 4 weeks just for people that are joining us online. And where's the camera? Can everybody see? Are you the camera right on me? Can you put the camera on the crowd for just a quick second, Dan? Everybody look at the back room and just wave like this to all the people that are watching online. People like Aaron and Ron LeCaire and Dorothy LeCaire are in the hospital today. Jacqueline Scott, who's home. Darla and Marla, my friend Cindy on the West Coast. We've got people all over the place joining us for worship. Any of you that are online right now that want to be a part of this group, what do they need to do? If you'll email Stephen@gracepoint.net, I'll get you connected with Trish, and we'll go from there. There's going to be a text group Pastor Paul leads for guys that just gets a text every morning. If you want that, you can call him. Worship team is going to have their own group, Maya. You guys are going to be joining us with your team. And then finally, our youth ministry, students, Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. It says here sanctuary, but we're going to be upstairs in the youth area. And so if you've got a teenager, middle school, high school, they can come on Wednesday night and they'll get connected. All right, did we get all that? Let me say it all one more time, just so you remember. No, I'm just kidding. Here's the most important thing. Be here next Sunday morning at 10 a.m. with somebody you know that needs a B12 shot for their soul. And we're going to study Romans chapter 8 over the next month. We're going to be meeting in all these different groups. Listen, this is the most groups we've ever had in the history of this church. So I think Tanya and Pat and all of our leaders that are leading these groups, I think we need to give them a big hand and say thank you. What that means is, if you're looking to call on the name of the Lord and be shoulder to shoulder with brothers and sisters in Christ, there's a place for you. You belong here. We want you to get plugged in and get connected. If you need any information, Tanya, you're going to be in the back. On their way out today, you can see her, get more detailed information. You can go reach out to one of the people that stood or raised their hands that are leading a group. If you prayed to receive Christ today, you can see Caroline or Wes on your way out. You can see me. We'd love to talk with you, pray with you. If you just want somebody to pray for you today, go back there in the back corner and see them. As you leave today, there's offering boxes on the back wall. Every time you give, you're helping change the world one life at a time. Those of you that are online, if you're part of the Grace Point family, go to gracepoint.net. Click on the word give, donate. Click on the word contact. It's like filling out an electronic welcome card. There's little cards in the chair in front of you. If you prayed to receive Christ today, or if you're new, if you're here for the first time, fill out one of those cards so we have your cell phone or email. We want to connect with you. We want to encourage you and help you to follow up. Whew. All right, I'm done. Pat, did I leave anything important out? Awesome. Thank you guys so much for being here. Thank you, worship team, for leading us. We hope to see you next Wednesday, next Sunday morning. God bless you, and you're dismissed.